Now, today I'm going to be preaching on the topic of music.
For those of you who have been to this church from the beginning, you've probably heard a lot of these points before. I don't know how many of you who are regulars here have actually heard those sermons back then, but I preached two sermons on music, but I've tried to condense it down to one, and I'll just try and squeeze it into the hour if I can. But I just wanted to preach on the topic of music just because obviously it's a big part of the church meeting here. And also, a lot of you, I think, weren't there when we talked about music. And a lot of people visit our church and they come here and they see that we sing a cappella. And, you know, we sing without musical instruments. And they sometimes wonder, well, is it because you don't have anybody to play instruments? As opposed to realizing that we intentionally have it that way because we believe that's the way the New Testament, that the Lord would have it. So that's what I want to talk about today. We'll talk about a few principles about music. And also why we do congregational singing the way we do, which is without musical instruments, so that all of us can be singing with our voices and praising the Lord with our voices. So let's jump straight into it. But let's look at two New Testament passages to do with singing in the New Testament. And we'll see here what should be the purpose of singing in the church in the New Testament. So there's one here in Ephesians 5, verse 19. It says, speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now, there isn't really much. Like, if you were to look, I'm not going to do that in this sermon I did before, but if you go to all the verses in the New Testament that mention music and things like that, there really isn't that much said about singing. There's probably about, I think there's about 8 or 9 verses, and then there are other verses, maybe another 10, that are mention music and singing, but are not really related to the doctrinal side of music and singing. But the parallel passage here in Colossians 3, verse 16 says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So really three purposes when it comes to singing in the New Testament church. Number one, you'll see in both passages, it says that we are singing to the Lord, right? So it says here, making melody in your heart to the Lord. Colossians 3:16 says, singing with grace in your hearts to the Lord. So number one is that we're praising God, right? We're singing to the Lord. Now, and we'll get into that in a moment, where we teach and admonish one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, ultimately, everything we do is to the glory of God, right? So even when it comes to singing in the New Testament church, we are singing to the Lord. We're doing it because God likes it. You know, that's one reason why we sing in church. When we come together as the body of Christ and we sing the songs, number one, it's commanded by God, but at the same token, God enjoys hearing you sing. You know, like maybe other people may not enjoy hearing you sing. You may not enjoy hearing yourself sing, but God, you know, He gave you your voice. He wants you to use your voice to praise the Lord. He enjoys hearing you sing. Look at Hebrews 13. Verse 15, we jump there. It says, by Him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God. I mean, think about it, we're reading through Leviticus, all the sacrifices. It's not just sin sacrifices, but also there was the offerings that were sacrifices too. And the New Testament, our praise to God is likened to like a sacrifice, like something we give to God that He enjoys, like that sweet-smelling savor that comes up to Him. It's like that when we praise Him, it's like it's going up to Him. He's enjoying that that praise and that offering. By Him, therefore, let us offer the sacrifice of praise to God continually. So you see, we continually do that, not only at church, but in our day-to-day life as well. That is the fruit of our lips, giving thanks to His name. So it's not just with the church. So you shouldn't just limit your praise and your worship and your singing to God at church. You know, a lot of churches, they think when they come together, it's like the worship service. And they think that worship is like an event that you go to, like I'm going to worship. But no, it says we sacrifice praise to God continually. Worship is a lifestyle. It's something that you are constantly doing. You're constantly thinking about God and glorifying God and praising God and even singing to God throughout the week, you know, with your family. It's not just something you come to church to do. But it also means that you have to be at church to do it, right? Like if you're not singing throughout the week and praising God, which you should be as well, but if you come late to church and you're not here for the singing, then you're not even doing it in church either. So you need to be on time, you know, come along for the prayer, for the preaching. Everyone always comes along for the preaching, but just as important as the preaching is also the singing as well, the praising of God, you know, praying for one another as well. And that's why we always tell people, you know, if you have prayer requests, you know, tell Michael and I so that we can get it on that prayer list so that we can pray for one another and we know and we can get to know what each other wants us, each other to pray for. So it's not just with the church, but daily in our personal lives. You might be thinking, oh, you know, why do we only sing old songs? You know, like, why do we only sing classic songs? Is that, are those only the songs that God likes? Is he only like songs from like the 1600s and 1500s? No, it's generally just a copyright issue, right? Because you don't know. But nowadays, like, people write all these songs, but they're all copyrighted, right? And then if you want to sing like all these songs in public and put them on the screen, you have to pay royalties and things like that. And it's just, we haven't got somebody in church that organizes all that. So we're just singing all these, you know, these non-copyrighted songs that are outside of the copyright laws and they're in the free domain. So I get a lot of our hymns from this website called Public Domain Hymns, pdhymns.com, and somebody's made all those slides. So we just go use those and we just sing the ones that I know, obviously. And that's why we sing those. So there's not like there's any reason why particular we sing those besides the fact that they're free to use, they're non-copyright, and somebody's already created the slides for them. So that's number one. Number one is to praise God. Let's go back to those passages there. So we'll go back to Ephesians 5 and Colossians 3. So the second one is to edify. So we see here speaking to yourselves. So that's where in Ephesians 5, in Colossians, what does it say? Colossians says, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. So the first purpose of singing is that we're praising God, right? God likes that. The second purpose is that we are learning things through the songs. And that's really one of the main purposes of music that we see in the Bible, that we learn things through the things that we sing. And it's another way that we can teach and admonish people through song. And that's why, you know, one of the most effective ways to teach things, even to children, is, you know, you put in a song. We think about, you learn the alphabet, right? And then how do you teach the alphabet? A, B, C, D. Here you sing it to the twinkle, twinkle, little star. So it's very effective to teach and admonish people in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, putting things to music. Even if you think about the Bible, I mean, the longest book in the Bible is Psalms. And what is Psalms? Psalms is a songbook, isn't it? And it's a songbook that's rich with doctrine, with prophecy. You think when Jesus was on the cross, what did he say? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? And do you know that he was quoting one of the Psalms? That was a quote from the Psalms. A lot of prophetical statements about Jesus Christ. And that's why when we sing in church, that's part of what we're doing. When we sing the songs, we are teaching one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And that's one reason why when you sing in church, you ought to sing to be heard by others. You know, like when we have the singing in church, you know, most churches you go to, right, it's more like a performance. Like you go to the church, you know, there's music going on and it's all about making people feel comfortable and having the atmosphere and things like that. Well, the music doesn't serve that purpose at this church. The music at this church is there for you to praise God, for you to teach one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And we'll get into the musical instruments in a second, a bit later on. So teaching and admonishing. Now, it's songs not just teaching you what is right, because you have songs that teach about doctrine, but you also are teaching you to do right. So you might have songs that exhort you and encourage you to actually, you know, get out there and do the work. You know, we'll work till Jesus comes. Or you might have a song that's more about doctrine, like Faith is the Victory. That's just talking about faith being an integral part of having victory in your Christian life. So both teaching what is right and exhorting you to do right. Now, you're teaching yourself when you sing, but you're also teaching others as well. So that's why it's important to when you sing in church, that you sing to be heard by others. Now, when it comes to being heard by others, people might say, well, you know, people just singing to be heard by others because they're trying to glorify themselves. But, you know, that's an issue of the heart, right? Whether somebody is singing with the right motive, you know, are they singing in order to sing to the Lord, to encourage other people to sing louder, or whether they're just trying to show off their voice? You know, just because somebody's singing loud, that doesn't necessarily mean they're trying to boast how great of a singer they are, because we don't know, you know, people ought to have the right heart, right? And the right heart is, well, I'm singing loud, not to show off how good I'm singing, but to sing loud, to encourage you to sing loud, so that you can hear what I'm singing, because you may not be familiar with the song. So if I sing louder, you'll get familiar with the lyrics, you'll get familiar with the tune, and then you'll be able to be encouraged and sing the song as well. So that is a very important point when it comes to singing in church, and especially in our church, because I know in our church maybe a lot of you are not very strong singers, but don't let that discourage you from singing loud. You know, sing loud. I remember when I was younger and I was going to churches, and you first get involved in a church and you're sort of shy about singing. And you're sort of worried about what everyone else is thinking about you singing. But then as you start to get to know everyone, everyone's not really thinking about your singing. They're thinking about their own singing. Everyone's just singing quiet because everybody else is singing quiet. And then you realize, well, if you just sing loud, you will actually encourage others to sing loud as well. And then that'll pick up the volume in church. So, you know, we've got to grow in that area as a church. You know, I feel like we're quite a quiet singing church. Like, there are churches that are probably half our size that could drown out this room. You know, because they're just all singing at maybe the volume that I'm singing. Now, with this sort of crowd, if we were familiar with the songs and we sang at the volume that, people would normally sing, I mean, we would fill this room with praise, and you probably wouldn't even be able to hear yourself sing. So, you know, definitely sing loud. You know, God likes to hear you sing. You know, other people should be able to hear you sing so that you would speak to yourselves and teaching one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. Now, because you're teaching through song, we're teaching one another, the way we ought to sing as well matters, in the sense that you need to be understood. Now, how many times do you hear somebody sing, and they might sing with like an opera-style voice or with a pop-style type of voice, and you hear them sing, you have no idea what they're singing, right? That's why when I'm up here singing, I'm not trying to impress you with like how fancy I can sing. I'm trying to sing clearly so you can hear the words, so that you are encouraged and taught by the words, you know? And that's why we have the words up there, so that you can read them and hear them. It's all about teaching and admonishing one another. So I believe that we should sing in a way that we ought to be understood what words we are singing. Not sing in a way that just sounds good, but nobody has any idea what you're singing. And if you don't know the songs, you know, you can learn them. That's why I'm trying now to record the music and put it up on YouTube. So if there are songs that you're not familiar with, you know, you can go on YouTube now and you can go on the hymns playlist and you can listen to them. And then you can get to know those songs. And then when you come to church, you can sing them along with us. And then you can sing them at home with your children as well. I don't know if all your children are the same, but when I just play the congregational songs from church, they all gather around the computer and they love listening to it as well. And then they get to know the songs. And even like, you know, Elizabeth and I will see just throughout the day, like Simon will be playing, or Timothy will be playing, or Sarah even will be playing. And they'll just be singing the hymns. And it's great to hear them singing the hymns just from being familiar with them and hearing them all the time. Now, because songs teach and admonish, obviously songs that have wrong doctrine should not be sung. So, you know, any church should be careful about what songs they choose to listen to or what songs they choose to sing, and make sure that the doctrine within those songs are correct. There are many songs that have wrong doctrine in them, and if they do, they should either be changed or they shouldn't be sung. So that's the second point. So number one is we praise God. Number two, we're trying to edify one another. We're teaching and admonishing one another, not just yourself, but others too. And not just what is right, but also to do right and to teach our children as well. And the last thing we see here is, in Ephesians 5 especially, speaking to yourselves. Now, this is why churches practice what's called congregational singing. So the idea is that you take part in the singing, because we're all teaching one another. We're all speaking to yourselves in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. The idea of music in a church is not a performance. It's not a group of people up here singing to you while you just sit back and enjoy the entertainment. That's not the idea of music in a church. It's the idea is for you to be a participant. You are the church. You know, when we think about church choirs, you are the church choir. You know, I'm looking at the church choir now. Right? And we sing to one another, we all take part, and we speak to one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs. And that's why we sing congregationally. I mean, we all sing together. Now, I already touched on the fact that, you know, you ought to be here. You know, you have to be here in order to sing to one another. If you only come later on throughout the church meeting, you know, you miss a lot of the singing in the beginning. So, you know, come here on time so you can be part of the congregational singing. But this is why we sing songs. If you're wondering why churches sing songs with sort of like a simple beat, a simple rhythm, That's why. It's because we want to sing congregationally. The rhythm is simple so that everybody can follow along and everybody can sing together. I mean, if you sing something like a pop song these days where it's more like a solo, I don't know if you've ever been in a church like that where they sing songs that are really hard to follow along with. And they have the songs up there, but the beat is so hard to follow along with, or maybe the person leading the music is singing it in such a way where it's really hard to follow along that you can't really sing congregationally. So that's why a lot of hymns and church music do just have that really simple rhythm, because then when you sing along, it's easy to pick up on that tune and sing along with everybody else. And this is why you wouldn't have, like, say, like rap music in church, right? You know, you have somebody up here rapping and stuff like that. How are you going to follow along with that, right? And sing along with that. That's why I don't have anything necessarily against rap music. You know, there's a time and place for that sort of music. It's just a different genre. Nothing evil in and of itself. But that's where, you know, you would use music for a more entertainment purpose or something like that, rather than in church, where the purpose is, number one, to praise God, number two, to edify one another, and number three, where we can speak together. We're speaking to ourselves and sing together as a congregation. So you can see that from these two, these are the two main passages, I'd say, in the New Testament that really give us a command of, you know, why we have congregational singing, what's the purpose of it, and explain to us, you know, this is the command of what to do when it comes to singing in the New Testament. And because it is about these things, what is important about a song is what is it teaching? The words, you know, what message is it trying to get across? Because obviously, if it's preaching lies, if it's teaching things that are false, we're not going to praise God with things that are false. And at the same time, we don't want to teach each other things that are false. So because that's the important part about music, that's how we judge music, right? Because people often wonder, well, how should we judge music? What sort of music should I listen to? Is this music that I'm listening to right or wrong? And really, that's what I would boil it down to is, well, you need to look at the words of the music. If the word, see, every song has a lesson in it. Every song is teaching you something. There's no neutral song out there that is, you know, that's not saying something. It's either saying something that is okay, it's lining up with the Bible, it's something that is right, or it's something that is wrong. So you need to keep that in mind when you listen to music and you're listening to the songs that are out there. There's so many songs that are out there, different genres. How do you judge what is okay to listen to and what's not okay to listen to? I believe it's the words, it's the lyrics, it's what is that song teaching you? Because if you like that song, obviously you're going to listen to it again and again and again and again. And if the words are wrong, teaching you something that's false, it's like you're listening to this sermon again and again and again and just drilling into your heart the message of that song. So we need to be careful what we listen to. Now, there are other subjective factors that people use when judging music that I think, like I said, are subjective in the sense that the factor in and of themselves is not wrong, but we just need to consider them, when we judge whether or not to listen to a song. Now, when it comes to these ones, like one I've got here is the age of the song. You know, whether a song is old or new doesn't make it good or bad. You know, because newsflash, like all the songs that we sing that are old today, they were one time new, right? Like, so you can't say, well, just because a song is old, it's good, and just because a song is new, that it's bad. You know, people say, you know, contemporary Christian music is bad, but you got to listen to the old-time hymns. But then the old-time hymns from the 1800s, in the 1800s was a new hymn, right? So back then, that was contemporary Christian music, so you can't just condemn something because it's new or something because it's old, because everything was new at one stage, and everything will become old at one stage, and that just doesn't make it right. So the age of the song is, you know, is just something that's irrelevant to how you would judge music. People would say, well, the types of instruments used. Well, you know, is a piano less evil than a drum kit? You know, people say like, well, you listen to that worldly music, it's got drums and cymbals and stuff. But then in the Bible, we see cymbals being used, you know, praise God on the high sounding cymbals. You know, is this drum kit behind me? People will see this drum kit, obviously they associate it with rock bands and things like that. So maybe it just has that association, but is this instrument any more evil than that instrument? I mean, they're just instruments, they're neutral, right? They're tools on how they can be used. So instruments in and of themselves are not evil. You know, it just depends who's using them, how they're being used. And obviously, because music is so effective, a lot of satanic bands and rock bands use it in order to, you know, allure to the flesh. And people enjoy that sort of music, and then they can preach their message through music. So that's another one. The type of instruments used, I think, is irrelevant to whether a song is good or bad. Number three, its effect on the emotions. You know, people say like, well, that song, you know, it invokes more emotions than another. But every song does that. You know, hymns do that too. There are hymns that, you know, if you've experienced, you know, what that hymn is talking about, or, you know, you've had God work in your life somehow, and you listen to a hymn, that can really touch your heart. So just because it invokes emotion, does that make it bad? You know, so there's nothing wrong with music invoking emotion. Like, I get it, it comes down to if it evokes an emotion, but it's teaching something false, that's where it's dangerous, right? Because you'll have an emotional attachment to it, but then you're actually learning something false from it, and it's being indoctrinated into you, and you may not realize. Another one where people say, well, it's the depth of the lyrics. They'll say, well, you know, this contemporary Christian music is so shallow in what it teaches, but, you know, the old-time hymns are really deep and things like that. Now, there are a lot of old hymns that are not deep, you know, that are, you know, when you think about God is so good, I don't know how old that hymn is, but, I mean, that's not very deep. You know, God is so good, God is so good, God is so good, he's so good to me. I mean, how deep is that? That's not that deep, right? But does that make it wrong just because it's not deep? So the depthness of the song is not necessarily a reason why it's right or wrong. There are just songs that are deeper than others. And like I said, it just comes down to what it teaches, not the depth of it. And there are other things like the style of music. You know, is one style more evil than another? You know, is there a certain pattern of notes or a certain way in order to play notes that makes one more evil than another? You know, is rock more evil than classical music? You know, when classical music came out, there were people, you know, you can read about it online, where people were criticizing that for being too upbeat and too fast and whatnot. You know, Fanny Crosby, I think, when she came out with the hymns that we would consider a pretty tame today, like Blessed Assurance, you know, a lot of the people in history, you read about people criticizing those sort of songs because they were too fast compared to the solemn music that they were singing back then. So I don't think a style of music is necessarily in and of itself wrong. And I think it just comes down to, you know, when I think about, you know, why is it that, you know, art has become so liberal and so wicked and so left-wing? I think it's just because people that generally... you know, and this is my opinion on it. When I see, you know, when you look at artists and things like that, you know, why are they so usually left-wing, right? And I think it's just because people that are left-wing, they don't care about the things of God. They generally, you know, just go with what they feel, right? They're not scared about what other people think. You know, they have no sort of limitations on what they might do. So they're a bit more out there. So they're the sort of people that go out there and become good at art and music and things like that. Whereas I guess people that are more right-wing are a bit more conservative, a bit more, you know, cautious of what they do. And therefore, they don't sort of excel in those sort of areas. But it doesn't mean they can't. Do you know what I mean? It doesn't mean that somebody who is a Christian, that is godly, that has principles, can't create music that is entertaining and yet at the same time teaches good principles and can be successful. So the style of music, I don't think, is necessarily an issue one way or the other. Like I said, it comes down to who is singing it. And that's one factor I've got here, is maybe the association. So that's where it is getting a bit more, you have to beware of it now. Is, you know, there might be a song that is associated with somebody that is ungodly, and you might not want to listen to that song, you know, because you obviously don't want to be associated with, like, maybe a satanic band or an atheist band or somebody that's openly, like, homosexual or against God. You know, why would you want to just fill their music, fill your heart with their music? But at the same time, you know, this is not a factor that is just clear cut, because there are songs that are created that are, you know, have nothing wrong with them. You know, like maybe, you know, Happy Birthday or Twinkle Twinkle Little Star. I mean, I don't know who made those. And they might not be somebody godly, but they're not necessarily an evil tune that's teaching anything wrong. So again, that I think is like, you have to be wise about, you know, what sort of music are you going to listen to? What sort of music are you going to allow your family to listen to? And consider these factors, you know, who is singing it? Because that's sort of tied in with what it's teaching, right? Because it's their example and their influence on your life. So there are some subjective factors, you know, when judging music. Now, one thing we definitely want to be aware of, and it's sort of tied in with this association, is we don't want to underestimate the power of music. You know, you don't want to underestimate the power of music. And this is why you want to be careful what music you're listening to and think about, you know, I'm not just going to turn on the radio and just listen to, you know, Carl and Jackie and whatever they play, just serve it up to me. That's the issue with having a TV in your house. Now, there's nothing wrong with having a TV as long as you are wary about what you're watching on that TV. You know, don't just turn on Channel 7 or Channel 9 or whatever and just let it play and just let whatever, you know, garbage into your mind and into your eyes. It's the same when you're listening to the radio and you listen to music. Don't just listen to anything just because it sounds good, not thinking about what it's teaching you and what effect it has on your life, because you don't want to underestimate the power of music. Let me show you this passage in Ezekiel 28, verse 13. We get a bit of insight into Satan. And I won't read the whole passage. I'll just read a couple of passages here. I'll just read verse 13. It says, "Thou hast been in Eden, the garden of God. Every precious stone was thy covering, the sardius, topaz, and the diamond, the beryl, the onyx, and the jasper, the sapphire, the emerald, and the carbuncle, and gold. The workmanship of thy tabrets and of thy pipes was prepared in thee in the day that thou wast created." So something that is interesting about Satan and one of his attributes is that he is a musical creature. So he is not only wise, you know, the Bible talks about him being wiser than Daniel. He's not only beautiful and very intelligent, right? But he is a musical creature. He is very good at music. And this is why a lot of artists attest to the fact that they have sometimes demonic influence, demonic, you know, ability, you know, satanic, like it's almost like demons or Satan has gifted them with musical ability to play as well as they do. So when you see a talented musician, it's not always, hey, wow, look at the talent that God has given him. Sometimes Satan has given them that talent in order for them to spread their message and spread their values. And this is why, you know, music is almost like a drug to some people. You know, like you listen to a set of music and the feeling and the emotion that it invokes becomes almost addictive. And you tell people to stop listening to a certain song and they can't. They just need it, right? Because it's so powerful how it can affect the spirit and the soul and just how it makes you feel. So you don't want to be naive to that in the sense that music is so powerful. I mean, that's one reason why God uses it, right? To teach things and to help us remember things. But Satan's going to use it too, right? Satan is a musical creature. He has his agenda, thank you. Yeah, he's got his agenda that he is trying to push, and he's going to try and push it through music. And if you just are not diligent and vigilant about what you allow into your heart, you know, he is going to get in there and influence you. And this is why sometimes people believe certain things about, you know, for example, romance. And it's not from the Bible, but it's just because they've been listening to these pop songs for so long about, you know, hooking up with some guy or hooking up with some girl, and that's romance, and just hooking up on a first date, rather than the principles that we see in the Bible of commitment and being pure and that sort of thing. So we need to get away from bad music with ungodly, worldly lyrics. Think about, what are you filling your heart and the hearts of your children with? I mean, especially if you're a parent here or you're thinking about having children and you're just listening to this music day in and day out in the car at home, I mean, your children are going to be listening to that too. And how is that going to influence them? We talked about, you know, famous musicians attesting to the fact of having these supernatural abilities by demonic forces. I think it's like some of the Beatles did. And who was that Jamaican guy? It was a Jamaican guy, right? That said that, you know, music was his religion. And he even attested to the fact that he was influenced by these demonic forces to have this ability. Now, they're preaching a message. So if you think about it, you wouldn't go to like the local satanic church, right? And sit in that church and listen to what the satanic preacher has to teach you. But yet you'll listen to the music. Do you know what I mean? So you got to put this in perspective. Like, you wouldn't do that. You wouldn't go and just go to the preacher and say, hey, teach me something. But these people that are openly satanic, you know, openly like worshiping the devil in their music, you'll listen to them for hours and hours on end, just soaking in what they want to teach you. What are you doing to yourself? What are you filling your heart with? I mean, do you think God is happy with that? You know, obviously, God is not pleased with that. So we need to get these things out of our life. And it's the same, you know, with movies. You know, movies as well have these themes of fornication, pornography, you know, sorcery, like, you know, Harry Potter and whatnot, you know, dysfunctional family, anti-biblical themes. And Christians will go and spend their money, go watch the latest movie and have no problem with it at all. And I just sometimes think, you know, when there was that part in the film where there was that, you know, immodest woman that was obviously put in that film just to, like, you know, expose herself to you. I mean, didn't it just convict your conscience a little? Just to think, man, I just spent 15, 20 bucks, you know, supporting this film, and yet it spits at God in the face, and I don't have a problem with that as a child of God. You know, these are the sort of things we need to think about. Like, I spend this money on iTunes buying all this music, and these artists blaspheme God. They make fun of God. They have a bad influence on society, and yet we are supporting their industry. We're supporting their art. When it hates God, what sort of Christians are we when we do that? And what sort of Christians are we when we don't have a problem with that? We, you know, we go to the movies, you know, we tell everyone that we watched the latest movie, and it's like, you know, we all know, you know, there's no Hollywood movie out there that's worth watching. You know, yeah, okay, they're entertaining because of all the fire and everything like that and all the explosions, but just like a sermon, right? Like a sermon, you come along, you listen to preaching, you know, in this church you may listen for an hour, you know, an hour and 15 minutes. And if you go away with one thing, hey, it's like, that's like an effective sermon, right? And it's the same with movies. You know, you watch that three-hour movie and Satan's just created that movie, you know, spent all that money on that movie just so he can expose you to a few things. And you've not only gone to watch it and have no problem with it, but you've paid for it. You know, you're the reason why they keep making them. You know, you wonder why they make like all these, you know, God-hating movies, or, you know, these biblical movies, like, you know, Noah came out and I can't remember what else came out. They make all these movies that basically make fun of the Bible, and you wonder why they keep making them is because Christians keep going out and watching them. You know, if you didn't spend money watching the movie, then they're not going to make them, right? So think about that. You know, just consider, you know, before you go out, you know, don't you love God? You know, don't we appreciate what God? Don't we appreciate what Jesus did when He died for us on the cross? He died for sin, and yet we go out and relish in it. We don't consider. You know, we say we love God, but with our life, you know, like, you know, all of us do that. I'm not just having a go at you guys. I'm just preaching to everybody. We do this in our lives, and we forget about God. We don't love God with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. We're just out there, you know, living for ourselves to satisfy the flesh. You know, how we spend our time, how we spend our money. You know, we need to come to church, be reminded, hey, put God first in everything that we do, and with what we watch and what we listen to, so that we can keep our minds pure and not be, you know, deceived by the world and have all these, you know, worldly ideas about how things should be in family and in love. And then we come and we think it's so normal for people to be homosexuals. We just think that, oh, you know, they're born that way and all that sort of stuff. And then you hear what the Bible says about them and you're shocked. See, and that just proves, you know, when you listen to the Bible, you're shocked by these things because you've been listening to the world for so long. You've been hearing those things. So we don't want to be naive about the power of music. We want to be vigilant about the music we listen to. Just think about, you know, it's things like, you know, you might watch a YouTube video that might not necessarily be bad to watch, but then the music behind it is not good. You know, and there's, you know, like if you just watch TV and online, there's the advertising and things like that. Don't just turn the radio on in the car. Maybe places that you hang out. Maybe there's a cafe that you hang out at and it's a nice place, but the music is really bad. So then go to another cafe. Don't hang out at that cafe. Or maybe like parties and work functions. That's why, like, I don't like going to my work functions, because my work functions is just like, you know, they go to a club or they go to a pub and just drink and play really loud music. So I don't want to go to those, you know. So think about those things. And you know, music and things that you see, obviously it's like toxins, right? Like, you know, when we eat, you can't get rid of all the toxins in your body. You know, you breathe it in, it's in our water, it's in our food, you know, poisoning everything these days. Now they're trying to force vaccinate us, you know, inject that stuff into our blood. But what you can do is you can minimize it, right? And it's the same with movies and music and whatnot. You can't totally get away from it in this world, but you can minimize your intake. And one way you can do it is you can replace a lot of these habits that you have. You know, instead of just listening to music in the car, you can listen to sermons, you can listen to an audio Bible, listen to podcasts and hymns, or, you know, maybe you can listen to just educational talks. Why don't you learn something rather than just listening to things that are going to rot your brain in the car or at home? So there's some good principles to music. Now, to answer the question of why we don't use musical instruments in this church, there's a few reasons, and I'll just go through them really quickly. But there's five reasons why I think we don't use music musical instruments in the New Testament. And some of them are just supporting reasons. And the fifth reason is really the foundational reason on why we don't do it in the New Testament. But number one is, like I was sort of mentioning with Colossians 3 and Ephesians 5, there really isn't that many scripture passages in the New Testament that deal with music. Now, we have these two commands, which are sort of parallel passages in Ephesians 5 and Colossians 3, but we also have examples of what the disciples did, and we'll just go through them really quickly, but you'll notice a pattern that it only really mentions singing. Let's go to Matthew 26. Verse 30, it says here, and when they had sung and hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Let's go to another one, Mark 14, 26. And when they, again, it's just a parallel passage. And when they had sung and hymn, they went out into the Mount of Olives. Acts 16, verse 25. This is when Paul and Silas were jailed. And, you know, there's the story of the Philippian jailer and that famous passage, what must I do to be saved? Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved in thy house. Well, preceding that miracle where God opened up all the jail doors, it says here, and at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God, and the prisoners heard them. 1 Corinthians 14, 15. We see here that when the church comes together, it says here, what is it then? I will pray with the Spirit. I will pray with the understanding also. I will sing with the Spirit, and I will sing with the understanding also. Another passage talked about, you know, when you come together, every man hath a psalm, hath the doctrines. You know, they're singing these psalms in church. But you'll notice here that there's never any instruments mentioned, is there? Let's go to the last one, James 5:13. Is any among you afflicted? Let him pray. Is any merry? Let him sing psalms. Now, this is what sort of really struck me first when I was studying out this topic and just sort of thinking about how to do things in this church, is that, you know, nowadays when you go to a church, right, music and the playing of musical instruments is a huge part of church, isn't it? Like in some churches, like, you know, they spend hours and hours a week practicing, putting on this big, you know, display and, like, all these different musical instruments playing, and it's like a big part of, you know, their worship service, right? And they're playing the music and singing. And what sort of got me thinking at first is, if that is what Jesus Christ intended for the New Testament, that it's such a large part of the New Testament gathering, why do we never ever read about it in the New Testament? We never see like one instrument ever mentioned, you know, in all the epistles, you know, when it comes to dealing with the New Testament church, when there are passages about singing and music, it's always about singing the songs, not playing musical instruments. You never see somebody carrying a musical instrument, or the music, or the musicians were there when they were at church. Nothing like that. There's no example of the New Testament Christians playing musical instruments. And it kind of got me thinking, you know, if it's such a big part, why is it never mentioned? Because we see everything else. If you think about all the key components of the New Testament church, we see it all. We see them gathering together. We see preaching. We see them breaking bread. We see baptism. We see, you know, them eating together. You know, what else do we see? We see them praying, you know, prayer and fasting. And we see singing, right? They sung in hymn. But yet we never see them ever playing musical instruments. You know, why is that? That's because I think it's God's intention that in the New Testament, it's not about the musical instruments. It's about you singing to God and using the musical instrument that God gave you to praise Him, rather than using your mouth to play, say, like a trumpet or something. He'd rather hear you sing than play that musical instrument. So that's number one. Number one is like we in the New Testament Gospels and letters, we only have example of Jesus and the disciples singing, not playing musical instruments. But number two, when we talked about Ephesians 5, if you remember Ephesians 5 and Colossians, speaking to yourselves in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, singing and making melody in your heart to the Lord. What was the other one? Colossians 3:16. Let the word of Christ dwell in you richly in all wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing with grace in your heart to the Lord. So we talked about the purpose, right, of music in the New Testament church, and we sort of went through that. And one thing musical instruments cannot do is fulfill any of those commands, right? We have these two commands in the New Testament that we are to sing, to teach one another, sing to the Lord, make melody in your heart to the Lord. But musical instruments fulfill none of these. Musical instruments don't sing. Musical instruments don't teach, right? Because you need to speak words in order to teach something. A melody does not teach anything, right? But words do teach something. They don't, and obviously they don't teach, they can't admonish, they don't speak. And you say, well, musical instruments make melody. But remember, it's making melody in your heart to the Lord. Now, a musical instrument doesn't make melody in your heart, does it? A musical instrument makes melody in a location. Whereas the melody in your heart is you. You're singing, right? And the, you know, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. So when you sing out, you're singing out the melody that is in your heart that the Lord wants you to make. So it doesn't fulfill. It doesn't even fulfill these commands. You know, when we play musical instruments in church. Now, I'll be upfront. You know, I'm not saying that musical instruments are sinful or they're wrong. I just think that their place is not in the New Testament church congregational singing. I think there is a place for musical instruments. And that's in the area of, you know, celebration. You know, we see that where the prodigal son came back and there was music and dancing because they were celebrating. So, you know, if you have a wedding or you have a party, you know, there's nothing wrong with singing there. There's nothing wrong with musical instruments. Playing music and celebrating, that's because it's for entertainment purposes. That's what musical instruments are for, is to entertain. But that's not the purpose in church. The purpose in church of music is for us to sing and praise God and teach and admonish one another. So number two is it doesn't fulfill any of those commands. Number three is, number three is because people will say, well, what about the Psalms, right? The Psalms have passages that seem to support the use of musical instruments for church singing. But the issue with the Psalms, you can't follow that reasoning consistently. Because that's really the major argument, right? Well, people will say something like, I'll show you this Psalm. I won't turn to all of them. But Psalm 33, for example, they'll say, look, rejoice in the Lord, O ye righteous, for praise is comely for the upright. Praise the Lord with harp. Sing unto him with a psaltery and an instrument of 10 string. Sing unto him a new song. Play skillfully with a loud noise. So that's the argument, right? The argument is, well, the Psalms talk about praising God with instruments. So number one, they'll say that's a command. But then they'll also say, like, well, how can, if you're commanded to sing in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, how can you sing a psalm about praising the God with instruments and then you don't praise God with instruments, right? That's the reasoning. And I'll explain why. I'll explain why, because you can't follow this consistently in the sense that you're saying, or you're singing a psalm about praising God with instruments. How can you do that yet not praise God with instruments? Well, number one is the command to sing in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs. You need to realize is we're not commanded to sing the psalms, you know, and hymns and spiritual songs. It's to sing in psalms because a psalm, you know, is a spiritual song. You know, I believe those three things are the same thing, like a hymn, a spiritual song, and a psalm. It's just the Bible just saying the same thing. It's like the Bible talks about, you know, the statutes, the commandments, and the testimonies of God or something. Like, it's just saying the same thing three times. That's what I believe. So a psalm, just like we see the book of Psalms, these are just spiritual songs that teach doctrine and things like that. And yes, there are 150 psalms that were the word of God, but when it talks about singing in psalms, hymns, and spiritual songs, it doesn't mean that we necessarily have to sing only those words. It's just singing spiritual songs. Now, I have nothing against people singing scripture in order to help memorize it and teach it and things like that. That's great. But you got to admit, when people try and fit the Bible passages to music, it doesn't work, right? Like, because they're trying. Have you ever heard like scripture songs and it just sounds so forced, right? Because obviously the Word of God, the Psalms were not originally written in English, you know. So as a song in Hebrew, it probably sounds good, but when it's translated to English and now you're trying to sing it, they're trying to have to fit it to a tune. And you know, sometimes it works. You know, I've heard songs like. There's a song that we used to sing that went to Romans 5, where it was like, went like this. He went, "Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which is given." Which is given unto us, to us, unto us. So sometimes you can find passages that fit songs really well. But, you know, I've seen a lady on YouTube try and sing just whole psalms to music. And it does sound a bit forced, because obviously the translation is not made to sing how we would sing songs in English. So first of all, that's not the commandment. The commandment to sing in Psalms is not means we are restricted to these 150 chapters to make music out of. You're just singing spiritual songs. So that's one point, right? But what about the issue of, you know, well, you're singing songs about telling you to praise God with an instrument of 10 strings, and yet you're not doing it. Well, I don't think that can be followed consistently, because let me show you these other two Psalms. This is Psalm 150. And this is a psalm about praising God. But you'll notice things in here that people don't do, right? Like it says, "Praise ye the Lord, praise God in his sanctuary." Now in the Bible, the sanctuary is the tabernacle. It's that tent that God commanded Moses to make where he was to be praised in. Now, nowadays in the New Testament, it's not about a location, isn't it? You know, we're praising God in a sanctuary, but you know, you don't always praise God in a sanctuary, right? You praise him outside. And it's not in the New Testament, it's not even about a location. You remember the woman at the well say, you know, do we worship God here or there? And Jesus, not on this mountain or that mountain. You know, God is worshipped in spirit and in truth. Praise him in the firmament of his power. I don't even know. Do you praise him in the sky? I guess I don't know how you'd do that. But praise him for his mighty acts, praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. So here's some musical instruments. But it says here, praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with string instruments. So a lot of people that believe, hey, well, the Psalms teach to praise God with musical instruments, how many of them would get up and dance in church? Like none of them would, right? So can you sing a psalm about praising God with dance and yet not dance? That would be an inconsistent position, right? If you're going to say, well, you know, we got to praise him because the Psalms say musical instruments, yet you're not doing all the things that the Psalms say. Praise him with dance. Praise him with stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. So a lot of churches would be against percussion instruments. But we see here, cymbals here. Praise him upon the high-sounding cymbals. Let everything that hath breath praise the Lord. Let me show you another one. This is Psalm 149. I know this is nothing new to the people that know these psalms and already sort of taught this before, but for those of you who are not familiar with these psalms, it's a new point for you. But Psalm 149. So again, remember this topic of, hey, their position is, well, if the psalms say to do something, you ought to do it, but they can't follow this consistently. Praise ye the Lord, sing unto the Lord a new song, and his praise in the congregation of saints. Let Israel rejoice in him that made him. Let the children of Zion be joyful in their king. Let them praise his name in the dance. So again, well, if they're going to be consistent, I want to see some dancing from them. If they say praise him with musical instruments, they should be dancing as well. Let them sing praises unto him with the timbrel and harp. For the Lord taketh pleasure in his people. He will beautify the meek with salvation. Let the saints be joyful in glory. Let them sing aloud upon their beds. So should we be like lying in a bed now? Let the high praises of God be in their mouth. And look at this, a two-edged sword in their hand. So if we shouldn't be singing a psalm that has musical instruments, and I'll explain why, you know, the Psalms talks about musical instruments in my next point. But if the position is, well, you shouldn't sing psalms about praising God with musical instruments and not do it, it's inconsistent. Well, Are we then expected to hold a physical sword in our hand as we praise God? So no, you see, you're starting to realize, no, there is. We have to understand the Psalms in light of the New Testament, right? What do these musical instruments represent in the New Testament? How are we to apply them? Because obviously there's the first application, which is, you know, David writing these Psalms and it being applicable to them in their day. But then there is the prophetical statements and how it applies in the New Testament, the spiritual meaning of them. What are the musical instruments in the sanctuary? What is the two-edged sword in their hand? Well, we know that's the Word of God, right? That we ought to have the Word of God with us. But look at this. To execute vengeance upon the heathen and punishments upon the people, to bind their kings with chains and their nobles with fetters of iron. So are they following these things consistently? Are they saying, well, how can you sing, if you're going to sing the Psalms about executing judgment on the heathen, shouldn't we be doing that too? That's what they would say, right? But we know, well, they wouldn't say that. My point is they're not following it consistently, because we know in the New Testament we don't wrestle against flesh and blood. It's a spiritual war. So that's why we don't take up arms. We don't physically go get a sword or a gun and then go execute judgment ourselves. That's up to the authorities and the government that is in place. To execute upon them the judgment written, this honor have all his saints. Praise ye the Lord. So again, these are things that we understand in light of the New Testament, that there will be one day when we will judge the unbelievers and we will sit in that judgment seat. But that is something that happens in the future after Jesus returns. So yes, there are passages that seem to support the use of musical instruments in church, but if we are to take that position, you can't follow them consistently, because there are psalms about executing judgment, there are psalms about holding swords, there are psalms about dancing, and these are things that they do not do. So that's another reason why, you know, we don't go to the Psalms to say, well, the Psalms say praise him with instruments, and just say, well, therefore, that's why you need to use musical instruments in the New Testament church. And some of the preachers that believe that will say it's sinful for you to not use instruments, right? They'll say, like, if you're not using instruments in church, then you're disobeying a command of God. But then wouldn't they be disobeying God if they're not holding a two-edged sword? If they're not dancing, then that would be a sin as well, right? With that sort of thinking. So it's not consistent. Now, where did musical instruments come from? And this takes a bit of explanation, so hopefully you can follow along. But why then do the Psalms talk about musical instruments? Where did the musical instruments come from? You're wondering, you know, God, you know, David obviously talks about praising God with musical instruments. Have you ever wondered where is the origin of why they even praised God with instruments? Here's a couple of things to think about. So number one is when Moses created the tabernacle, and we've been reading through that as a church just recently, you know, the end of Exodus, when God gave command to Moses to build the tabernacle and to build all the equipment in the tabernacle. One thing you'll notice in those instructions is that there were no instructions to build any musical instruments, right? They built the Ark of the Covenant, the tabernacle, and the very specific instructions on how to build it, the table, the bowls, all these sort of things, the candlestick, and all that sort of stuff. But there were no instructions to build musical instruments. And I believe it's because God never intended them to worship him with musical instruments. I don't know if you realize, but you know, like when you're reading through, whether you can picture what's actually getting built, but you know, obviously there's the tabernacle, which is the tent. It talks about all the cloth, the blue, the purple, and all that sort of stuff. And, you know, there's the ark, which is like this big box with cherubims, you know, with their wings made of gold going over it. And then you remember there was the rings that had to be made on either side. So if you can imagine in your head, it's like there's the rings on either side of the box, because the staves, which were like these wooden sticks plated with gold, would go through those rings, and then the Levites could put the staves through those rings and then carry them, right? And it would be born. And same with the table. The table, if you remember, had rings on it as well, and the staves went through it. So they could carry, you know, this whole setup, you know, wherever they went. And that was one of the jobs of one of the sons of Levi. I can't remember which son it was, but they all had different jobs. One was like packing down, one was like the sacrifices in it, and the other was like carrying things. So that's what's kind of interesting. If you think about that, that's what's actually being described in Exodus, you know, the latter part of Exodus, is the detailed instructions of what to build. But there's no instructions of building musical instruments. Now, even the temple, you know, later on they worshipped God in a building. Do you know that God never actually intended that building? You know, so God intended a tabernacle, right? And we read about this story. I'll show you here in 1 Chronicles 17. 1 Chronicles 17. So what is happening in 1 Chronicles 17 is David, right, he's king now, and he's built himself a house, right, a house of cedar. And he's sitting in his house, and it says here, "Now it came to pass as David sat in his house that David said to Nathan the prophet, 'Lo, I dwell in a house of cedars, but the ark of the covenant of the Lord remaineth under curtains.'" So he's referring to the tabernacle, right? The tent that God commanded Moses to make, the way he would be worshipped and all the sacrifices would be done. So David's sitting in this house and he's thinking, "Man, I've got it so good. I've got this house, this physical, you know, made of wood, but God's presence is sitting in under curtains." So he says, "Then Nathan said unto David, 'Do all that is in thine heart, for God is with thee.'" So Nathan sort of says, "You know what? Well, go and do, because, you know, God's with you." And that's something we have to be careful of, right? Because Nathan was actually wrong, you know, because God comes later to Nathan and says, "No." And it came to pass the same night that the word of God came to Nathan. So just because somebody is being used by God doesn't mean everything they do is right. Right, so we have to be discerning. Nathan wasn't discerning. He was just thinking, "Hey, man, God's using David. David's filled with the Spirit. I mean, anything he does must turn to gold, right?" But that, you know, you don't judge whether something's right or wrong based on who's doing it. You got to judge it by the word of God. And it's anybody. You know, there are great preachers out there doing a great work. That doesn't mean everything they say is right. If it doesn't line up with the Bible, if it doesn't line up with the word of God, it's wrong. And it came to pass the same night that the word of God came to Nathan, saying, "Go and tell David my servant, thus saith the Lord, thou shalt not build me an house to dwell in. For I have not dwelt in an house since the day that I brought up Israel unto this day, but I have gone from tent to tent and from one tabernacle to another." Now, why is that? And you know, it's probably because, you know, the idea of the tabernacle is that it was temporary, right? Because the fact that we are sojourners here, this world is temporary. God's not setting up his kingdom permanently here. That's why I think he intended the tabernacle. It would move with them and it was a temporary dwelling place. "Wheresoever I have walked with all Israel, spake I a word to any of the judges of Israel whom I commanded to feed my people, saying, 'Why have you not built me a house of cedars?'" So God's saying, "Did I tell anyone to build me a house? No, I commanded a tabernacle. "Now therefore thus shalt thou say unto my servant David, thus saith the Lord of hosts, I took thee from the sheepcote, even from following the sheep, that thou shouldest be ruler over my people Israel. And I have been with thee whithersoever thou hast walked, and have cut off all thine enemies from before thee, and have made thee a name, like the name of the great men that are in the earth." We'll just skip down a bit. Here we go, verse 10. And since the time that I commanded judges to be over my people Israel, moreover, I will subdue all thine enemies. Furthermore, I tell thee that the Lord will build thee an house." So you see what God is saying here? He's telling Nathan, right? And then Nathan goes and tells David. So David wants to build a house for God. And God tells David, "You know, I've told you to build a tabernacle. I've never told anybody to build me a house. And in fact, you're not going to build me a house. I'm building you a house," right? Because God is going to build us a house and we're going to dwell in that. "Lord will build thee an house, and it shall come to pass when thy days be expired that thou must go to be with thy fathers, that I will raise up thy seed after thee, which shall be of thy sons, and I will establish his kingdom. He shall build me an house, and I will establish his throne forever." So kind of an allusion there to the Trinity, where God says he's going to build the house, but at the same time his son is going to build the house, because Jesus is God, right? "And I will be his father, he shall be my son. I will not take my mercy away from him as I took it from him that was before thee, but I will set him in my house and in my kingdom forever, and his throne shall be established forevermore." Now, us looking back on this Old Testament passage, who is that talking about? Obviously, it's talking about Jesus Christ, right? Jesus Christ, his seed will come, it will be established, his throne will be forever, and he will build us an house, right? Now, what's interesting about this is when you see later on in Chronicles 28, I'll show you here, First Chronicles 28, verse 17. First Chronicles. Maybe it was 2 Chronicles. Did I write the wrong reference? Maybe I wrote the wrong reference down. But basically, I'll explain it to you. But what's interesting about this is when David later on tells Solomon to build his house. I just wish I had the. Maybe I should try and find it. Just wait a second. I think I wrote the wrong passage down in my notes. So, because I really want to show you. How did I write that down? I know it's First Chronicles. Yeah, thanks. I wonder. 28:7, right? So it's a bit further up. Oh, because I put 17 instead. I left a 1 in there. That's what threw me off. So. First Chronicles 28. Oh, here we go. All right, now this is later on. So we read in First Chronicles 17 where God came to David, right, and told him, you're not going to build me a house, I'm going to build you a house, and his son's going to build him a house. Well, what's interesting in First Chronicles 28, when David actually recounts that passage, you'll see here, then David the king stood up upon his feet and said, hear me, my brethren and my people. As for me, I had in my heart to build an house of rest for the ark of the covenant of the Lord and for the footstool of our God, and had made ready for the building. But God said unto me, thou shalt not build an house for my name, because thou hast been a man of war and hast shed blood. Now, do you remember reading that in the encounter? No, right? So it's interesting that David is sort of presuming why God doesn't let him build the house. It's not just that, because God is obviously prophesying about Jesus building the house and never intending a temple to be built. But David thinks it's because he's been a man of war, that's the reason why God didn't want him to build the house. Howbeit, the Lord God of Israel chose me before all the house of my father to be king over Israel forever, for he hath chosen Judah to be the ruler, and of the house of Judah, the house of my father, and among the sons of my father he liked me to make me king over all Israel. And of all my sons, for the Lord hath given me many sons, he hath chosen Solomon, my son, to sit upon the throne of the kingdom of the Lord over Israel. And he said unto me, Solomon, thy son, he shall build my house and my courts, for I have chosen him to be my son, and I will be his father. So isn't that interesting that when God told David, hey, you know, your son's going to build your house, obviously talking about Jesus Christ, it's almost as if David understood that incorrectly and thought that he was talking about Solomon, right? And the reason why he didn't build the house is because he was a man of bloodshed. So the point I'm trying to make here is, I don't think God ever intended to build the temple. Do you know what I mean? Like, God intended to build a tabernacle. He didn't intend to build a temple. David, I think, misunderstood what God was telling him, and he thought that God was telling him that Solomon was going to build the temple. And that's why David went and he collected all the cedar, he made all the plans, he set it up so that all Solomon had to do was build the temple and go ahead with it. And then even Solomon later on in 1 Kings 8, we won't go there for sake of time, repeats David's words and said, my father couldn't build it because he was a man of bloodshed, but I am raised up in my father's day. You know, God said, I would build this temple. So it's almost like this message was passed down, but was actually misunderstood incorrectly. And then the temple was built, even though it was never intended. Now, where did musical instruments come from? Now, musical instruments, when we go to 1 Chronicles 6, 31, we'll see here, and it says, and these are they whom David set over the service, now just note that word, service, of song in the house of the Lord after that the ark had rest. And they ministered before the dwelling place of the tabernacle of the congregation with singing until Solomon had built the house of the Lord in Jerusalem. And then they waited on their office. So what is happening here in 1 Chronicles 6? I just wanted to show you here that 1 Chronicles 6, if we see here in verse 1, it's a genealogy in the family of Levi. And we get down to verse 31 where it was the Levites that were put in charge of the service of the house of the Lord. And part of that was the playing of musical instruments. Now, the reason why David set that up, and you can read about it more in 2 Samuel 6 and 1 Chronicles 13 and 15. I'm just running out of time, so I'm trying to go through this. But if you know the story, if you remember when the Israel in the days of Saul fought the Philistines, remember they brought the Ark of the Covenant out to that battle, and they were like, "Yeah, the Ark of the Covenant's here," but then they lost it anyway, right? Because obviously the Ark of the Covenant doesn't mean that God is necessarily on your side. And then the Philistines, remember, they took the Ark of the Covenant and they were struck by, you know, emeralds and all that sort of stuff. And then they sent it down the river and all that stuff to give it back to the nation of Israel because God was plaguing them for having it in their presence. Well, when we come to King David, David actually wants to bring the Ark of the Covenant back to Israel, right? And the first time, and you read about this in 2 Samuel 6. But if you remember, the first time they bring it back, they pick it up and then they put the Ark of the Covenant on a new cart, right? And then they're bringing it back. And that's when David first praises the Lord with musical instruments, because as they're bringing it back, he's made all these musical instruments, he's set the Levites to play them, and as they're bringing it back, they're playing musical instruments and praising the Lord, bringing it back. And what happens? If you remember, because they put it on a new cart, they were not following how it should be carried, you know, by the Levites. What happened? The Ark of the Covenant shook, right? And then Uzzah put forward his hand to steady the ark. And then what happened? He was struck dead, right? And then they left it at Obed-Edom's house rather than bringing it all the way into the capital city of Israel. And going back to those rings, because remember the Ark of the Covenant had those rings. It was the Levites that were meant to carry the Ark of the Covenant, and they weren't doing it properly. So then later on, they got the Levites to carry it in, and they're playing these musical instruments, and that's when, you know, Michael sees, you know, David dancing and praising God as they're bringing it back into Jerusalem to rest, and she despises him, and then that's why they never sleep together again. She doesn't have any more children. So that's that story, and that's where musical instruments came from, and it's actually clear in the Bible that the musical instruments that were used to praise God in the temple and in the tabernacle before David built the temple were actually set up by David. And we can see a lot of passages here. So 1 Chronicles 23, verse 5, where the Bible makes it a point that the musical instruments were of David. Moreover, 4,000 were porters and 4,000 praised the Lord with the instruments which I made, said David, to praise therewith. I'll show you another passage. 2 Chronicles 7, 6 says here, and the priests waited on their officers, the Levites also with instruments of music of the Lord, which David the king had made to praise the Lord, because his mercy endureth forever. When David praised by their ministry, and the priests sounded trumpets before them, and all Israel stood. So you can see here that it is David, number one, that built the temple, and David, number two, that created the instruments in order to praise God with, because David was a very musical person and he set this up in order to praise God. We see even here in Amos, when I'll show you this verse here, in 6 verse 5, when it's actually talking about the ungodly nations. I'm not saying that music is ungodly, but it says here, they chant to the sound of the viol and invent to themselves instruments of music like David. So it's just saying here that people create musical instruments. David also created musical instruments to praise the Lord in. Now, even though God did not intend a temple, it's interesting that God still blessed the temple, right? In the sense that after they created the temple, the cloud came into the temple and God blessed it and still used the temple as a shadow of the New Testament, in the sense that our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost and things like that. And even the fact that God didn't even tend a king, and yet the king is a shadow of Jesus Christ being a king, and you know, he uses those shadows. So even though God did not intend to build a temple, God still blessed David's works and used it as a shadow of the heavenly temple. And we see there, I won't go to all these passages, but where obviously God filled the house of God when they built the temple, obviously, you know, showing that he was blessing that work. And even later on, when Hezekiah repairs the temple, the Bible actually makes this phrase here. I'll show you here in 2 Chronicles 29, verse 35. It says here, so they set in order, the burnt offerings were in abundance, with the fat of the peace offerings and the drink offerings. For every burnt offering, so the service of the house of the Lord was set in order. So even though God never intended it, David did it, it was something that he invented, God still blessed it and used it as a shadow of things in the New Testament. And it became one of the things that the Levites would do then, right? When they actually praised God, part of it now was they would offer the sacrifices in the temple and also play the musical instruments and praise God in the service of the house of the Lord. So the last point I want to talk about is why then, even though God blessed the temple, he blessed this practice of praising him with instruments in the temple, why we don't do it anymore in the New Testament. And the reason is, and we'll go to Hebrews 9, Hebrews 9 verse 14. Hebrews 9, 1 to 14. The reason why we don't do it in the New Testament now is because the New Testament teaches that the Levitical priesthood and the sanctuary and all the things of that divine service of the temple are done away with, that were to do with tabernacle. Because remember, originally it was in the tabernacle and then it moved to the temple. And that service is now done away in the New Testament. That's why you realize in the Old Testament, it's only Levites playing musical instruments, right? Because it's part of the service of the house of the Lord that the Levitical priesthood was performing. It says here, then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service and a worldly sanctuary. So you see there was that tabernacle, which was the sanctuary, and all the service that was happening in it. And part of that was the praising of God with musical instruments. For there was a tabernacle made, the first wherein was the candlestick and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary. So when you see those psalms talking about praising God in the sanctuary, it's referring to the tabernacle. And then later on it moved to the temple. And after the second veil, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, and it talks about all the services that were in there, and we'll skip this for sake of time. But we see here the Holy Ghost is signifying that the way into the holiest of all was not yet made manifest while as the first tabernacle was yet standing, which was a figure. So that tabernacle and all the divine service, which was a figure for the time then present. So it was for that time only, in which were offered both gifts and sacrifices, which could not make him that did the service perfect. So you see there's a reference there to the priests and the Levites offering all these gifts and sacrifices, and part of that was the worship of the Lord within that house with the musical instrument, which stood only in meats and drinks and diverse washings and carnal ordinances imposed on them until the time of Reformation. And what is that? Well, verse 11 talks about Christ being come. So now that Christ has died and risen from the dead, there is a change in that old covenant to the new covenant, and there's a change in the priesthood. That's why we don't do those things anymore. We don't offer the animals and do all that divine service, because it was temporary. It was imposed on them for a temporary time until Jesus Christ died and rose again. And now we are in the New Testament. So this is why you don't see it in the New Testament anymore, because it was part of the divine service in the temple. But in the New Testament church, what do these things represent? Right? Well, obviously we've got the temple, which is our body. So what do the musical instruments then represent? It's the making melody in your heart to the Lord. That's why in the New Testament, it's all about singing, right? Because just like there was praise and worship within the temple of God in a certain location, what is the new temple of God? Our body is the temple of God, and the singing and the praise and the worship happens within that temple. And that's why in the New Testament it's all about singing now. Now, somebody might say, another argument would be, well, what about in Revelation, right? Because Revelation, there is, you know, the harping of harps and things like that. So, and I haven't left that out, but let's go to Revelation 14. I'll show you an example where God is being praised with musical instruments in heaven. And it said here, I heard a voice from heaven as the voice of many waters and as the voice of a great thunder. And I heard the voice of harpers harping with their harps. And they sang, as it were, a new song before the throne, and before the four beasts and the elders. And no man could learn that song but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. So another argument people might have is, because we already talked about the Psalms, right? So that's not held consistently. But also in Revelation, they don't follow that consistently either, because they'll say, well, if God likes being praised with instruments in heaven, why wouldn't he like being praised with instruments on earth? You know, that's a fair argument. But that's because the real temple is in heaven, right? So remember, the reason why God built a tabernacle, and that's the place that symbolized where he was worshipped, and they did worship God, and then David set up the musical instruments. I think part of the reason why God allowed that is because he is worshipped with instruments in heaven, right? So, you know, he sort of allowed that, even though he never intended that on earth. So he built the tabernacle, and then he blessed the temple because the temple represented the real temple that is in heaven. And in heaven, God is worshipped with musical instruments because it is a location, and musical instruments create music within a location. So in here, they are in the throne of God, in the temple of God, praising God with musical instruments. But one thing as well you'll notice in Revelation, when you read through Revelation, and we go here to Revelation 8, that there are also other things that God does in heaven. He says here, "And I saw the seven angels which stood before God, and to them were given seven trumpets. And another angel came and stood at the altar, having a golden censer." So you see here in heaven, in the temple, there is an altar. Why? Because remember when Moses was commanded to make the tabernacle, remember it was a picture of what actually existed in heaven. He was making things that he was shown that actually existed in heaven, and the things that he made on earth was a picture of those things. So the whole Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat, that's where God is actually dwelling, you know, between real cherubims. But then Moses was commanded to make golden cherubims to represent where God was dwelling. So that's why there was an altar and the golden censer, you know, the censers that he made, the incense that they burned. These are things that are also mentioned in Revelation, what is happening in heaven. But people that say, well, there's musical instruments being used in heaven to worship God, wouldn't also say, well, therefore we should have all these things as well. We should have an altar, we should have incense, we should have the censer, we should have these things. No, because these things are done away in the temporary Levitical priesthood that God had ordained in the Old Testament that's done away with. But in heaven, they do exist, right? Because that's how God wants to be worshipped in heaven. But on earth, in the New Testament, like I said, we are that temple. The musical instruments represent the melody that is happening in our heart. So I hope that gives you a good idea of why we do things the way we do. It sort of teaches you a bit there. I know it's a lot to put in because I kind of tried to condense it down to one sermon. And I understand that, you know, most Christians these days are not really used to that. Obviously, if you come from a fundamental church that, you know, does a cappella singing, you know, you would be used to that. But if you're used to the more modern, contemporary churches like Hillsong, where musical instruments and the performance is a big thing, you might come to a church like that and it kind of feels awkward, kind of feels silent and things like that. And, you know, I agree, you know, there are pros and cons to obviously musical instruments. Like some of the cons I've got listed, you know, if you play musical instruments, obviously you can fill the silence between certain things. You know, especially if you're doing communion, there's that silence that happens, and some people might find that awkward. But it's only awkward because you expect sound, right? If you don't expect it, then it's not awkward. Like if you just know how this church is, it's not awkward for you. Some of the cons. So just briefly, some of the cons and pros of musical instruments. I mean, a con is if people play musical instruments just for the sake of playing musical instruments, but they're not skilled, sometimes it's very awkward, right? They can put people off, you know, when you're trying to sing. Have you ever been in a church where you're trying to sing and the musician's not that good and it kind of like puts everybody off? So sometimes it's like that. Yeah, that's why it's important to have a strong song leader because he has to sort of keep everyone together. And people might say, well, if you can't sing, then you can't participate in the music, right? At least somebody who is dumb, meaning like they can't speak, can at least play a musical instrument. But, you know, that's an exception, of course. You know, we're commanded to read the Bible, but if somebody's blind, that doesn't negate the command to read the Bible. It's an exception, right, that people cannot necessarily speak and therefore can't participate in the congregational singing. People say, well, it's less entertaining. You know, if you come to church, you know, you don't sort of have that atmosphere. And again, that's not what church is about. Church is not about for you to come here and be entertained. It's for you to take part. It's for you to be a blessing to other people. It's a place for you to be provoked unto love and good works. So you shouldn't just come to church just to listen and not sing. You know, you're not coming here just to be entertained. You come here to take part and to sing to one another. But you know, some pros to not using musical instruments is like you don't have to have the logistics, you know, like carrying them around. If it's not, you know, us, we would have to put them here and take them away. But also, like, you know, they take up more space. Like, you'd need space to actually have all the musical instruments, especially if you have an orchestra. It's also cheaper. You don't have to spend money on them. But one good advantage of not having musical instruments is that everybody is singing. Do you know what I mean? Like, because if you're playing a musical instrument, generally the musicians are not singing. But if you have congregational singing without musical instruments, everybody sings. And if you sing loud enough a cappella, you will drown out the musical instruments, unless they're amplified, right? Unless they're hooked into a sound system. And then they'll drown out the people, and then you can't even speak to one another, right? Because you can't even hear each other. But generally, when a cappella singing is really loud, you can't hear the piano that's trying to, play away in the corner if the congregation is that big. And then also, if you don't have musical instruments, it's also easier to hear others singing, because you want to be able to hear people singing alongside you rather than just hearing this draining or droning out your music that's being played over the loudspeakers. So like I said, I don't think musical instruments are sinful. That's not the point of this sermon. The point of this sermon is for you to get an understanding of why we do things the way we do in this church, and that it's actually based on biblical principles, and that's why we sing a cappella, not just because we don't have a musician to play for us. But there is a place for musical instruments, and that is in entertainment, right? And what I just want to finish on is I want to read to you a couple of quotes just from historical sources and a few quotes from, sort of like people that are known as the forefathers of Christianity. And obviously this is not a reason why not to play instruments. But I just want you to see that the playing of musical instruments is not actually a historical Christian thing. It's just interesting. Now, my position is, we don't base what we do based on what we read on historical books or quotes from previous Christians, right? And that's why I've sort of argued it from the Bible. But I want you to see that this is not like a minority view. Like, there are other people out there that believe that musical instruments are not for the New Testament church. So here are three quotes just from historical sources. And I won't say the reference, I'll just read the quote, but it says here, all our sources deal amply. So these are some voices from history, right? People who are documenting what happened historically in Christianity. It says here, all our sources deal amply with vocal music of the church, but they are chary with mention of any other manifestation of musical art. The development of Western music was decisively influenced by the exclusion of musical instruments from the early Christian church. So we see that the early Christian church didn't use musical instruments. We have no real knowledge of the exact character of the music which formed a part of the religious devotion of the first Christian congregation. It was, however, purely vocal. Here's another one. Both the Jews in their temple service and the Greeks in their idol worship were accustomed to sing with the accompaniment of instrumental music. The converts to Christianity, accordingly, must have been familiar with this mode of singing, but it is generally admitted that the primitive Christians employed no instrumental music in their worship. Now, these are a few quotes from different Christians, and obviously I don't believe like their teachings, but it's just interesting that they believe these things as well. This one is from John Calvin. Musical instruments in celebrating the praises of God would be no more suitable than the burning of incense, the lighting up of lamps, the restoration of other shadows of the law. The papists, so the Catholics, therefore have foolishly borrowed this, as well as other things from the Jews. Men who are fond of outward pomp may delight in that noise, but the simplicity which God recommends to us by the apostles is far more pleasing to him. Now, obviously, Calvin is wrong on a lot of things, but this is one thing I do agree with him on, in the sense that, he's recognized that it's part of the Levitical priesthood, and to bring it back would be to bring back things that are done away. Now, here's one from Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Now, he's a heretic, but I just wanted to show you here that, obviously there's the Protestants, like the Presbyterians, but it's not just a Catholic thing, right? There were also people that were part of the Baptist movement that also recognized that musical instruments should not be used in the church. He says here, I would as soon attempt to pray to God with machinery as to sing with him with machinery. So what is Charles Burgess saying there? Like, we wouldn't get on our knees and pray and then play a piano to pray to God. So we wouldn't do the same to praise God. We would praise him with our mouth, the fruit of our lips, not with machinery and musical instruments. Now, this is my favorite one. This is from John Wesley. This is the founder of the Methodist Church. He says here, I have no objection to instruments of music in our chapels, provided they are neither heard nor seen. So I think that's funny. He's basically saying, you can have musical instruments as long as nobody can see them and hear them. So just a couple of quotes there. I just thought it was interesting. But I hope you that was an interesting sermon for you, and you sort of learnt something there today. All right, let's pray, and then I've got just a couple of announcements, and then we can spend some time chatting. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Lord, for your word. Thank you for you know, the direction you give us. It's just interesting to learn about all these stories and what we can glean from them. Pray, Lord, that you know, this not only taught people about the principles of music, but also, you know, musical instruments, where they came from, and also just gave them a taste of, you know, just the how interesting the Old Testament stories are, and just things we can learn from how you set things up and what you commanded Moses and David and things like that. I pray, Lord, that you would continue to help us study the Bible and just help us to hone our positions on the things we believe, and pray that you would just build us and strengthen us, so that, Lord, as we grow in our faith and grow in knowledge, that we would be more bold in how we preach the gospel and how we share our faith. We praise you, Lord. Thank you for Jesus, and pray you'll bless the rest of our meeting. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.